This episode of Look, Look and Look Again is suitable for persons of 12 years and over. Thanks for watching.
In our initial exploration and revisiting of the mesmerizing giallo film genre, we dive headfirst into Freudian depths for this episode, where all the quintessential giallo elements converge in cinematic significance. Enter Libido, a creation helmed by the visionary duo of Ernesto Gastaldi and Vittorio Salerno. This film stands as a trailblazer, following in the footsteps of Bava's The Girl Who Knew Too Much and Blood and Black Lace. Beware the precipitous clifftops, for this journey promises thrills and brooding kinkiness beyond imagination. Libido emerges as the brainchild of none other than Ernesto Gastaldi, a luminary whose impact on the giallo and horror genres rivals that of Bava and Argento, and the entire array of Italian cinematic talents. Gastaldi stands as a pioneering figure, one of the first to specialise in giallo and Italian horror, a genre that took its fledgling steps with Bava's I Vampiri in 1957. Born in 1934, Gastaldi's passion for film and literature ignited at a tender age. His journey led him to the prestigious Centro Sperimentale di Cinematografia, where in 1954 he directed the movie short La strada ci portava lontano. Gastaldi proudly referred to it as Italy's first true thriller, regrettably never saw the light of a theatrical release, and as at the time of writing this, has faded into obscurity. Gastaldi at the time did not find writing the screenplay for cinema easy, and his journey is summed up when he said the following in an interview.
The beginnings were not easy. For a couple of years I went around the production offices loaded with subjects that nobody wanted to read. Then I entered the stable of the great Ugo Guerra, and as a ghostwriter I wrote about 20 films. Then Ugo took me with him to the producers, and then I started to work on my own. Since then it was easy. Our commercial cinema was experiencing a boom in sales abroad in all countries of the world. In those days, writing for the cinema was the most beautiful job in the world. We met intelligent people. We spent hours and hours commenting on life and laughing about it, always in the midst of beautiful women. You were the first to get paid. You could write when you wanted, where you wanted, alone or with whoever you wanted. The large public did not know us, and therefore no one bothered us if we went to the cinema or for a walk. But we were highly esteemed among those who counted and courted by actors and actresses.
The 1960s marked Gastaldi's prolific era, as he delved into both novel writing and screenwriting. His talent graced scripts for films like Renato Porcelli's Vampire and the Ballerina in 1960,
thank you.
the wonderfully titled Werewolf in a Girl's Dormitory a year later.
Mr. Swift. Mr. Swift, what are you doing? Can't you hear me?
Ricardo Freyda enlisted Gastaldi's prowess for Freyda's Hymn to Necrophilia, The Terror of Dr. Hitchcock, in 1962, and he also contributed to Bava's S&M theme to The Whip in the Body, and Antonio Margheriti's The Long Hair of Death, another vehicle for actress Barbara Steele. Gastaldi never held back on themes strictly for adults, and despite the limitations on what could be shown, tried to push elements of perversity as far as he could. While Gastaldi's versatile career spanned Italian genre cinema, including spy thrillers, spaghetti westerns, gothic horror and peplums, his crowning achievements arguably lie within the realms of giallo. He graced this genre with unforgettable works such as So Sweet, So Perverse, The Mesmerizing Strange Vice of Mrs. Ward, and the intriguing The Case of the Bloody Iris during giallo's heyday in the early 1970s. Gastaldi's contributions to Italian cinema are immeasurable, even if his name doesn't always leap to the forefront of our minds. Despite this, he deserves as much kudos as his contemporaries.
Alla radice dell'anima, dove il sentimento è istinto, non c'è distinzione tra ciò che è odio e ciò che è amore. Libido, un genere nuovo di suspense, una sottile angoscia dove la bellezza è pericolo e l'amore si cambia in una diabolica arma per evocare le ombre del passato e i fantasmi dei terrori infantili.
Per un momento mi sono sentito come lui. Anch'io ho provato il desiderio di stringerti, di farti male.
Mi lasci, lasciami!
Brigitte.
Un invito alla notte. E dalla notte qualcosa si muove. Crescendo di suspense, mai visto finora sullo schermo, esplode in un allucinante finale, illuminando per un attimo la spaventosa realtà. Dominique Boschero, l'enigmatica moglie di un giovane miliardario. Mara Maril, una rivelazione tutta bionda, un continuo invito all'amore. John Charlie Jones, il giovane che ha paura di se stesso. Alan Collins, l'ambigua figura del tutore. In un film nuovo, di rara potenza emotiva, che scava nei più inconfessabili recessi del nostro io. Libido.
In Christian's formative years, a haunting incident left an indelible mark on his psyche when he and Jiminy Cricket unwittingly witnessed a grim murder at the hands of his own father during a rather kinky bit of sex play with a peroxide trollop. 2 decades passed, marked by his father's demise, and now, with an inheritance beckoning, Christian embarks on a fateful journey alongside his bride, Helene, their legal guardian, Paul, and Paul's wife, Brigitte. Their destination, not just the ancestral family home, but the very site of that traumatic crime, all in a courageous bid to confront the shadows of the past. Yet, as they step into this eerie realm, a foreboding unease begins to creep over the quartet. Strange and unsettling events unfurl, and Christian, once confined to the walls of an asylum during his turbulent youth, finds himself haunted by the terrifying notion that he might be following in Daddy's ominous footsteps. The lines between reality and delusion blur, leaving a disconcerting question in the air. Is Christian descending into madness, or is a sinister plot unfolding around them? In this enigmatic tale, where the past refuses to stay buried and the present is shrouded in mystery, the scene is set for a chilling exploration of the human mind and the shadows that linger within it. Libido serves as a chamber piece that holds a special place in Gastaldi's career as it marks his directorial debut in the realm of feature films. This intriguing cinematic journey commences with an attention-grabbing Freudian quote, immediately immersing the audience in a world of psychosexual tension that will unfold over the course of the movie.
I mean by libido, the quantitative expression of the energy of all those tendencies that emerge from the slimy sea of the unconscious and add up in what we call love. That complex of impulses that Plato calls eros and that the Apostle Paul praises in his letter to the Corinthians. But these tendencies can be channeled, or be channeled on wrong paths, generating in the individual a serious sense of guilt. And this is possible especially in the period from birth to the pubertile threshold, as the traumas of childhood more easily influence the libido of the adult individual, modifying and sometimes alternating sexual dynamics.
Interestingly, the inception of libido is tied to a rather unique origin story. During an interview, Gastaldi shed light on the film's unconventional beginnings, revealing that it emerged as a result of a wager between the esteemed screenwriter, producer and director Luciano Martino and Martino's wife, Mino Loi. Gastaldi said that,
I was there, by chance. I'd never directed a movie in my life and I had a beautiful wife at home who aspired to be an actress. So I proposed myself.
Collaborating closely with his wife, Mara Marrill, who also takes on the role of the flirtatious yet somewhat airheaded character Brigitte in the film, they crafted a Freudian narrative featuring 4 characters ensnared within the confines of an isolated setting. While the film incorporates the fundamental elements of the giallo genre, it predominantly prioritizes the nuanced development of its characters and the establishment of a distinctive mood throughout its duration. It's worth noting that the end result may come across as dialogue-heavy to some viewers, especially those with a poor attention span, and it might be perceived as relatively mild by contemporary standards. However, for its release year in 1965, Libido introduced elements of kink, hysteria, psychosexual delirium, and a subtle hint of lesbianism, pushing the boundaries of the era's cinematic norms and what was allowed. Nevertheless, Libido shines in its ability to weave a hypnotic atmosphere uniquely its own. In my humblest opinion, dear viewer, this film deserves a broader audience as it offers a captivating cinematic experience that remains distinctive despite the passages of time. Gastaldi often teamed up with Vittorio Salerno to co-write and co-direct. Gastaldi said that
Vittorio Salerno was the brother of Enrico Maria Salerno, a famous Italian actor. Vittorio and I wrote the script based on my wife's idea and we offered the part of Paul to Salerno. Enrico knew that this film was going to be made, and it would make his brother a director before him. So he proposed to play the character as a monster, blind in one eye and hook on his right hand. He accepted, just to pull his leg, but I called Luciano Pigozzi. In this new situation Vittorio was useless, but I shared the director's credit with him all the same.
Despite Gastaldi's status as a novice director, his handling of the material and libido is nothing short of commendable. The film exudes a brooding sense of claustrophobia, skillfully maintained throughout its array of shocks and twists, all the while guided by a steady hand. While the pacing may be deliberate, dear viewer, rest assured it never succumbs to tedium. The production of this cinematic gem came at a cost of 26 million lira, a figure that belies its worth when considering the reception it received abroad. Shot in monochrome, but richly cinematographed over a mere 18 days, Libido proved to be a financial powerhouse, reportedly raking in more than 10 times its budget at the international box office. What makes Libido even more remarkable is that its title remained unchanged when released internationally, a rarity within the ever-evolving world of giallo cinema. As we shall soon discover, giallo film titles tend to morph and sometimes perplexingly overlap with those of their contemporaries. Not J&B this time around, but Cutty Sark Whiskey is the favoured choice of libation. In the pivotal role of Christian, we witness the debut of the talented actor Giancarlo Giannini, whose prior experience included appearances on both stage and television. Following his performance in Libido, Giannini's career took an impressive trajectory, leading him to collaborate with distinguished filmmakers. Notably, he appeared in director Luchino Visconti's L'Innocente in 1976 and ventured stateside in the 1980s, making notable appearances in Ford Coppola's segment of New York Story's Life Without Zoe in 1989 and Guillermo del Toro's Mimic in 1997. His breakthrough moment after all this time arrived when he assumed the role of Mathis in the James Bond films Casino Royale and Quantum of Solace, sharing the screen with Daniel Craig's incarnation. Remarkably, Giancarlo Giannini's foray into the giallo genre was relatively brief, with Libido being one of his few ventures in this realm. He also made a notable appearance in the superb The Black Belly of the Tarantula in 1971, before parting ways with the genre completely. It's worth noting that the initial offer for Christian's character had been extended to Franco Nero. However, Giannini's compelling intensity and his impeccable portrayal of the character's descent to madness ultimately secured his place as the leading man, a feat that he executes here with remarkable finesse.
Christian, what are you saying?
He didn't have me all figured out. On the way, I picked up this.
Give me that pistol.
No, I'll keep it. I'm keeping it.
In my opinion, Paul Benoit would not be capable of doing such a thing.
Dominique Boschero steps into the role of Helene, showcasing her versatility in both French and Italian productions. She was known to cinema goers before this in peplum adventures such as Ulysses against Hercules, and spy thrillers such as Secret Agent against Fireball. However, it was her appearance alongside Audrey Hepburn in When Paris Sizzles that introduced her to a broader international audience. Boschero didn't shy away from the enigmatic world of giallo, making her mark in three notable films of the genre, The Iguana with a Tongue of Fire being one in 1971, Who Saw Her Die, the second, and thirdly, The Bloodstained Lawn. For those with a taste of the more sleazier side of cinema, one, it wouldn't be look, look, and look again if we didn't delve. She ventured into Faccia di Spia in 1975, which is a Mondo-esque show-and-tell piece of scuzz that delved into the alleged workings of the CIA and featured some notably lurid torture sequences, including the vivid and very fake image of a metal rod being inserted into a penis and then the said rod heated up. Remarkably, this marked Boschero's cinematic swan song, and she maintained a low profile until her resurgence in 1989 with a television appearance in the Italian drama series Passioni, where she played the part of Maria Carla Arnold for an impressive 100 episodes.
Come out of here.
But why? It's so sexy.
Not this room. I'll explain later.
Oh, so many Bridgets. Oh!
To play the part of Brigitte, we encounter the talented Mara Merrill, who also happens to be Gastaldi's wife and occasional collaborator. Merrill's portrayal of Brigitte comes very close to stealing the spotlight, her audacious quirkiness proving to be a standout feature of the movie, while her striking looks and alluring figure had the potential to catapult her into the upper echelons of Italian cinema. Merrill's presence on screen remained relatively Spartan. Born in 1939, she joined hands in matrimony with Gastaldi in 1960 and collaborated with him on screenplays for several movies, including the giallo plodder The Scorpion with Two Tails. Merrill effortlessly embodies the fashion trends of the mid-1960s, channeling influences reminiscent of the iconic Brigitte Bardot in vogue at the time. Yet beneath her fashionable exterior lies a character who skillfully manipulates the situation right before the audience's eyes. When it comes to Brigitte, appearances are indeed deceptive, and Merrill's portrayal keeps viewers guessing throughout the movie.
I think he's afraid of becoming more like his father.
Is he dangerous?
I certainly hope not. However, Dr. Berger says it's not impossible that returning here to his father's place might suddenly reawaken the child of shock.
Completing the ensemble in the role of Paul is Luciano Pigozzi, who interestingly goes by his customary anglicised pseudonym Alan Collins. Undoubtedly, this performance ranks among Pigozzi's finest, and he seizes the opportunity to shine as the enigmatic, shifty sugar daddy of Brigitte. While Pigozzi often found himself cast in smaller, sinister roles that capitalised on his distinctive features, Libido offers a rare glimpse of him taking on the substantial and central character that carries some of the weight of the entire feature. He was a familiar face in films directed by luminaries like Bava and Margheriti, cementing his status as one of the most cherished screen talents during Italy's revered golden age of horror and thrillers. For fans of giallo, Pigozzi's appearances in iconic titles like Blood in Black Lace, All the Colours of the Dark, and The Case of the Bloody Iris remain unforgettable, adding to his legacy as a beloved figure in the realm of Italian cinema. He's a kind of pasta Peter Lorre. Well, dear viewer, Libido was an absolute delight for me. It's one of those perfect choices for a rainy Sunday afternoon, and we've got plenty of those to come. And while it may lack the high body count we often associate with giallo, it remains an utterly captivating experience. It stands as one of the early black and white gems in the giallo genre, just before the blood begins to flow crimson and giallo transforms into a tapestry of pop art peril. What sets Libido apart is its seamless blend of the successful gothic elements popular at the time, and by now starting to fade out, with the emerging giallo style influenced by Bava. The entire cast exhibits fantastic chemistry, ensuring the viewers are never left wanting. Even when the film reaches its dramatic conclusion, you're not shortchanged with this one. Furthermore, the film's settings are a visual treat, ranging from the sprawling estate with its dark, foreboding interiors to the mod-infused allure of the mirrored room. And let's not forget the breathtaking coastal landscapes used to great effect with their rugged cliffs and rhythmic crashing of ocean waves, undulating ferocity, and then serene, only to flare up again and again tempestuously. A visual nod to the Maelid's imbalanced mental state, no doubt. What an ideal! All masterfully captured through Gastaldi's lens and interpretation. All this, dear viewer, and Jiminy Cricket as well, bless him. In the end, Libido is a decent nugget of thriller cinema, and giallo in its own right. Severin Films in the USA brings us a gorgeous high-definition treat in their 2022 release on Blu-ray with some smashing extras. For those in the UK, you'll have to rely on the import, as the movie is not currently available anywhere in any digital format. Now there's a surprise. Based on this, Libido gets 3 cutthroat slices out of 5 from yours truly. Well, that's all from me this time round. Please join me again next time for another giallo treat. Until next time on Look, Look and Look Again. Cheerio.